a start. As you've seen, we've been joined by all our friends from the armed forces, all of them very resplendent, has to be said. Can we make certain that we sure all phones are turned to silent, please, and when people do speak, they try to speak as closely as they can to the microphone, and it is because there are people who can't hear our deliberations. You may recall I previously signed the Armed Forces Covenant on behalf of the Command Authority, and I'm very pleased to advise that our collective commitment to the City Regions Armed Forces community has now been developed into an MOU, a Memorandum of Understanding. It's a particularly appropriate juncture, I think, that we're now ready to sign this agreement, given that it's Armed Forces Week. And I noticed Joe in Liverpool last night as we were walking through, at the back of Exchange Flags, there was a commemoration of our forces going on. So it was, I think lots of people who were interested in this. I think it's a real key step for the City Region, though, to be making certain that we do everything that we said in the Covenant in regard to working with our armed forces in the future. And certainly a lot of work that our individual authorities do with armed forces, veterans, I think some of the best practice in that whole country you can find in our City Region. So before we start the actual meeting itself, can we invite Commodore Waterhouse to say a few words, please, to the Commander of Authority?
Ladies and gentlemen, may I thank the Mayor on behalf of the Armed Forces community for his very kind words in relation to the sailors, soldiers, marines and airmen of the regular and reserve forces, whether serving or veterans, and by implication his positive words in reference to our families. Now, it was one of our old foes, Napoleon, that he used to say, and I paraphrase here, that a soldier would do anything for him in return for a medal. I think it's safe to say that today's service personnel delight and thrive on the support of the community we serve and ultimately protect. The medal helps and recognises formally, but it's the support of the populace of the UK that really matters to us, and that's why the Armed Forces Covenant is so important to us, and to our own personal support mechanism, our families and our own communities. With that in mind, may I say how honoured I am, and my colleagues, are to be invited to take part in the signing of the broader MOU in relation to the individual Armed Forces Covenants within the Liverpool City Region and six local authorities. This is an important step in revalidating our individual partnerships and reiterates the outstanding support the Liverpool City Region is delivering for the Armed Forces community. As we've heard, the Armed Forces Covenant is a promise from the nation that those who serve or have served and their families are treated fairly and not disadvantaged. We're working with businesses, local authorities, charities, community organisations support the Armed Forces community through the provision of services, policy and projects. Now, whilst I would argue that there's always been an unwritten covenant, formal signs across the North and the wider UK have shown the incredible and measurable support the Armed Forces have today. In my role as a Naval Regional Commander for the North of England and the Isle of Man, I've been both delighted and humbled to see the real and tangible benefits of the Armed Forces Covenant. And they are there. Believe me, I challenge the councils and companies who have signed the covenant to give me that evidence of real support to the Armed Forces community. And please also believe me when I say that I've seen no badge collecting here. Those that have signed the covenant are truly delivering. I mentioned the Armed Forces community just now. That Armed Forces community is much broader than many think. I realise that the cadet forces are not within the framework of the Armed Forces Covenant, and I would challenge you to ask why. But there are over 7,000 cadets and approximately 360,000 veterans just in the Northwest. And of course, in between those are those that serve now. Men and women, both regular and reserves, are exceptional people. But then you know that, and you delight in it. But our exceptional people are supported by other exceptional people. And I'm continually struck by the overwhelming support of our families, the local community, the third sector, and the council of officers of the regional and local authorities who continue to give so much to those of us who serve and have served in the armed forces. You, as I say, are exceptional people too. So please do continue to support us. I know I speak for all of us when I say that we admire initiatives such as this MOU, which goes far beyond that of the Armed Forces Covenant and will enhance the understanding and collective output of the region and therefore the delivery of community services to the Armed Forces Cardiff. But we don't want it to be all take nor one-way traffic. For our part, in amongst our established outreach, outputs and events, we are committed to working with Liverpool City Region and local authorities in order to identify and develop opportunities that enhance this MOU vision. This includes assisting in the development of young people to create the talent pool for the future prosperity of the Liverpool City Region. Understandably, this may include a culminating point of regular or reserve service for a number of years, but we will return them to the local talent pool eventually, and that can only be of huge benefit to all of us in this part of the country. Finally, you should all be justifiably proud of the support that you give to the Armed Forces community and their support networks. To the mayors, the leaders of the councils, the Armed Forces champions and assisting officers, and to the populace at large, a profound thank you for all you have done, all you do, and for all that you will do in the future. We are extremely grateful. In short, Liverpool City Region, Combined Authority, Liverpool, Sefton, St Helens, Knowsley, Wirral and Halton, we salute you.
Thank you, Commodore. Can I invite you and the other armed forces representatives to join me up on the dais and the leaders, please, of the six local authorities?
This is a sort of template, so come and
walk around. We'll play again in a minute.
Thank you. public. Okay, yes, thank you. Thank you, ladies.
Thanks, Commodore. If we do get a chance at the end of this meeting, which shouldn't take that long, just outside there is a warm memorial, so we can go outside and gather there and take a photograph of ourselves with the armed forces. And I don't know if this is true, Commodore, but I was told that there are more Scousers in the armed forces per capita than any other area in the country. So even if it's not true, I'm repeating it. So I believe it to be so. But thanks very much for that. Okay. Great. Okay. On to the full agenda then. Apologies for absence. Trudy's going to run through that.
Apologies have been received from Jane Kennedy, Councillor Moran, Councillor Emily Sporrell, Sarah Wyne McCowan, and Reverend Loudon.
Any further apologies? No, okay. Item 2 is declarations for members. Item 3 is the minutes of the previous meeting of the Combined Authority held on the 31st of May 2018. Can I ask that those minutes are agreed, please?
Agreed.
Can we, on those minutes, can we add the two confirmations of the deputies?
Agreed.
4 is the mayoral announcement since last we've met, and a huge number to start with, congratulating Councillor Derek Long and all the staff at St Helens Council for winning the Municipal Journal's Award for the Best Council for Care and Health Integration this week. Well done to all. Fantastic achievements. I'm sure everybody will agree it's well deserved. It also, as well, highlights the fact that Mike Palin's not here, so we can send our very best wishes to Mike Palin for a speedy recovery. I'm sure Mike was integral to that achievement. Since that last meeting, I hosted all of the English regional mayors who came here, including the Mayor of London, and that was to lobby the government to introduce further reforms to the skills sector. Councillor Mayor has been leading on this, but he'll be aware more than everybody else, I think, of the need for us to ensure that we get our skills strategy right so that we can take our economy, both locally and nationally, to the right levels. And it's unacceptable that the government's flagship, the apprenticeship levy policy, has resulted in, now it was £1.28 billion. I believe that has increased to £1.8 billion. That's been to be confirmed by the IFS, but that is a huge chunk of money. Even based on the lower figure, it could amount to more than 200,000 apprenticeships, and it represents then 200,000 people who have got a missed opportunity because they're not being given that chance for an apprenticeship. I think it's unacceptable. We as a city region, I think, are doing really good stuff on this, and I've been asked to lead and to promote a campaign across the north with Northern Powers Partnership, which we'll be starting, I think, in a fortnight's time. But it is to try and get hold of some of that residual funding. I also went to the Northern Rail Summit, which was in Leeds or Newcastle? I'll be Manchester this one. Okay, I went there with, because of the problems that have been experienced by the travelling public in regard to Northern Rail, and I have to say, Chris Grayland's mishandling the situation, and I have suggesting that, I believe currently, because it's ongoing, that his position is untenable. But the situation is not improving to the degree that we need to. An emergency timetable, an interim timetable was introduced, and Northern Rail aren't even meeting the lowered expectations of an emergency timetable. But it's not just Northern Rail, it is Network Rail as well. And what I've put a marker down to say is that whilst Network Rail are concentrating on trying to put some of the problems that they've caused to Northern Rail right, that can't be at the detriment of what's happening in our city region. We've got a huge programme of works. We've got £460 million worth of brand new rolling stock being introduced. Our programme of works can't get further and further down the priority list, so that we end up with brand new rolling stock sitting in sidings and still have to use 50-year-old trains. So I think that's something that all leaders are very cognizant of the need to do. I attended an air quality summit as well with Councillor Natalie Nicholas, who's the Deputy Portfolio Holder for Transport and Air Quality, and that was in London. I remember that one. It was hosted by CityCar, and it was made up of elected representatives covering approximately 20 million people across the whole United Kingdom. And the Secretary of State, Michael Gove, was there in person to hear of our demands. And that is a target national vehicle, which is a vehicle renewal scheme to enhance clean air. In other words, the autocracking system that Gordon Brown introduced, but we need one of those for certainly the high polluting vehicles. We are yet to hear back from our suggestions. And I've continued to do some of the local meetings in each of the six districts, and at the next available opportunity, I'll update people on some of the initiatives that are coming forward, certainly one in regard to improving the availability to look at master planning for our town centre areas. Okay, so the last one is the Convention of the North, where myself and Frank went to on Saturday, last Saturday, and it was to officially launch the event on the 6th of September, which has a number of ambitions. So they are pan-Northern positions on Brexit, obviously, transport, as I say, about Crossrail for the North, Northern Powerhouse Rail, whatever we want to call it, to make certain that skills is right at the top of the agenda again, and also to make certain that the North is not left behind the rest of the country, with Parliament continually looking toward what happens in the south of the country. So we'll, when we get some further information on the 6th, when I think core leaders, leaders of the core cities and metro mayors and others, including LEPs, have been invited to that, we'll report that back. But it is trying to get our act together. Basically, we've got 16 million people in our area and very, very little in the way of influence with national government, whilst London has 8 and a bit million people and has an awful lot of influence with governments, and that needs to be rebalanced. Okay, so item 5 is the scrutiny review of air quality across the Liverpool City region, and Kirsty's going to talk us through this. I'd just like to say that I'd like to thank the outgoing chair of the scrutiny panel for carrying out this, and all the members who took part in both reviews, this one and the next one. Okay, so he's going to talk us through the findings of the scrutiny panel.
Yeah, so the report identifies that air quality issues may not be as visible as they've perhaps been in the past, but there are still significant health and social implications which need to be tackled. The report suggests raising the profile of air quality issues. It suggests communication and education for people is going to be particularly important. It makes important links with our transport policy and supports producing an air quality action plan. And you're asked to approve the recommendations.
Any questions? Can we approve the recommendations as set out on page 13 in the report then? They agree with you. Item 6 is a scrutiny review of welfare reform, something that's been close to most of our hearts, but Kirsty will take us through conclusion of that report?
So this report on welfare reform concentrated on universal credit, and it identified some areas of good practice that are happening across the city region. But it also identified some issues with universal credit, including a lack of consistent advice, issues for people who are already vulnerable, and concerns over the time that's taken for people to receive payments. The recommendations include that you as Metro Mayor write to government setting out findings of the report and the concerns and raising those, but it also suggests sharing learning across the city region and sharing best practice, and again, you're asked to approve the recommendations.
Are there any questions on the report? Can we agree the recommendations are set out on page 27?
Agree.
Item 7 is the Combined Authority Financial Performance Report, and it's the outturn of 2017-18, and John Fogarty is going to take us briefly through this item.
Yeah, very briefly. It's the position at the end of the last financial year. It's presented in three parts really. There's the revenue outturn, which shows that there were a number of timing issues, notwithstanding around the certain activities around the single investment fund. It also identifies the performance of the tunnel tolls in particular to provide a revenue position at the end of the last financial year. Then moves on to consider capital, in particular the LGF and the Strategic Investment Fund funded schemes, which, as you will see from the report and previous reports to the Command Authority, the issue at the end of last year was really turning some of those projects really strongly into the delivery phase. And that gets closely monitored, as you know, and we'll come back with regular monitoring reports on that issue. The third part of it is the Treasury Management element of it, which is basically to assure the Combined Authority that the Treasury Management strategy that you determined in April 2017 was compliant with throughout the financial year 2017-18. So that, as I say, is a brief counter through it. Happy to answer any questions you may have on that.
Any questions for John on the report? In that case, can we agree the recommendations that are set out on page 39, please? On item 8, public question time, we have received two questions from Dr. Woodcock, the details of which have been circulated to members and copies are available in the public gallery. Can I therefore invite Dr. Woodcock to read out his questions?
Metro Mayor and members of the Combined Authority. Unlock Democracy welcomes the opportunity to ask questions to the LCRCA and values the undertaking that there will usually be a response within a specified number of working days. We understand that similar public bodies such as the Liverpool CCG make provision for the replies not only to be sent directly to the person or organisation submitting the questions, but that the responses should also be in the public domain and included in the minutes. If this request is approved, perhaps the previous responses to Unlock Democracy could also be included in the minutes of the next meeting. As a second question, Unlock Democracy has expressed concern that the three previous overview and scrutiny committees have been incorrect. The meeting scheduled for the 6th of June was deemed to be unconstitutional, and the next meeting, we understand, is now scheduled for September. What measures are being proposed in future to remedy these serious shortcomings?
Thank you, Dr. Woodcock. As you know, we will respond within 10 working days. Just to say that it's something positive that's come from your two questions, and we'll inform you, and we will post them on our website. So, but there's also something else that we'll thanks a lot for that. 9 is petitions and statements, and we've not been notified of any petitions or statements. And 10 is a nomination report, and it sets out a number of appointments to external organisations and to the Combined Authority Committee, so Frank's going to briefly talk us through this one.
Thanks.
Thanks, Chair. This report is to recommend a number of appointments to external organisations and to some of the committees of the combined authority. The recommendations are 2.1. We're effectively looking for confirmation of Councillor Dean Stapleton to the Overview and Scrutiny Committee, as is detailed in Section 3, and the approval of the appointment of the officers, as detailed in Section 4. There is a requirement for two substitute members to be nominated and seconded to the Chrysalis Board, and a requirement for two members to be nominated and seconded to the Workforce Engagement Board.
Okay, we've previously been notified then that we've got Councillor Wendy Simon and Councillor Davis as the two substitute members for the Chrysalis Board. They agreed. Are there any nominations for the Workforce Engagement Board?
Chair, I move Councillor Graham Morgan.
Chair, can I move Councillor Dennis Bob as well? Okay. That's not tit-for-tat, is it? Is that agreed?
Easy.
Any other times? Okay, with those four recommendations, can they be agreed? Item 11 is the minutes of the Transport Committee, and they were held on the 7th of June 2018. The minutes are in draft, and they will be submitted to the next meeting of the Transport Committee on the 12th of July of 2018 for them to be approved as a true and correct record. Are they agreed? Okay, the next meeting of the Combined Authority will take place on Friday the 27th of July at 1 o'clock here in the Authority Chamber. I declare the meeting now closed.